have Simon Harmon talking to us about multifunction PCI. Thank you.
Now? Yeah. I'm going to be talking about some work I did with people at Fujitsu on PCI pass-through. I'm going to start by explaining what that is and what I've been doing, and I'm going to go into a bit of more detail. So the aim of the project that I worked on was to basically enhance PCI pass-through and specifically to allow multifunction pass-through. And the aim of this presentation is to explain what that means and why it's interesting. So first I'm going to talk about what it is. Okay, so PCI pass-through, which is also sometimes called direct assignment, and it also has several other names that I'm not familiar with. It's basically the idea that you take a PCI device and you give it to the guest. So this gives you... The reason this is nice is because it can be very fast. It's very simple because the hypervisor and the layers in between don't need to know anything about the device. So if you have some esoteric device that there's no support for, but you want to just give it to one guest, you can. The disadvantages are you can't share the device anymore, and you can't migrate the virtual machine so easily anymore. If you want to do this, you really want to have an IOMMU or VTD-enabled machine. Otherwise, you can still run it, but basically you compromise your system because you give the guest DMA access, and if they can DMA some memory in the system, they can DMA any memory in the system. So they could use this to, for instance, overwrite the memory where the hypervisor is. This discussion, I'm going to be talking about Xen, but it's kind of applicable to other virtualization technologies such as KVM, and I'm going to be talking about fully virtualized hosts, although it's mostly applicable to power virtualized as well. Okay, so I'm just going to start right at the beginning explaining a little bit about PCI works, how some terminology relating to PCI that I need in order to talk to you. So PCI device is comprised of PCI functions. This is the lowest unit. PCI device may have one function or it may have up to seven. And on a usual system, you have a bit of a mixture of both. The thing that's most important about this function versus device thing is a device must always have function zero. So if and we're going to see that during the course of this talk, this is going to crop up a few times, that function zero is a bit special. So here's an example of LSPCI on a single function device. It's not very exciting, it's just standard Ethernet controller. The important thing is that there's only one thing in that list. And this is an example of a fairly common multifunction device. It's a USB controller. You can tell it's a multifunction device because you're on the same bus, that's the 00 thing. And they're the same device, that's the 1D thing. And then their function numbers differ. That's the 0, 1, 2, 3, 7. And this is a valid device. It has function 0. And on the previous slide, we can see that the single function device also has function 0, which is good. Okay, next. So how did PCI pass-through handle multifunction devices in Xen before I changed it? Basically, you could map all the functions. That's not true. You could map functions into an unprivileged domain, a guest. But you can see they've all turned up as individual devices. That's why there's kind of gaps between them. So there's virtual device 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. That's not really the same as a single device that has five functions. And that might may cause some problems. And it takes a lot of slots or we've now basically taken up five device slots in the guest just to essentially pass through one device. So that's not very good. And it was especially not good because at the time there was a limit in Xen that you could actually only pass through two devices. So this scenario was actually completely impossible. So this is what we want. We want to be able to say here's a physical virtual multifunction device. We want it to look like, when it's virtualized, we want it to be still a multifunction device. Like that. It's pretty straightforward. Here I've just done a one-to-one mapping. I'll talk about that a little bit more, but we can see here that this device, which is 1D, physically 1D, is now in the guest, number 8. Okay, so that's not very exciting. How does pass-through work in Xen? I'm going to talk about that a little bit now. There are four operations that form the system. The first two are quite complicated, the last two are extremely simple. We need to be able to attach devices. So you can think about this as hot plug, and in fact that's how it kind of works internally. So you add a device. You could do this at boot time, you could do it later on while the system's running. And then you can do the reverse. You can detach devices while it's running, so that's hot unplug. And then you can list the devices that are attached, and you can list the devices that are eligible to be attached. So how does all of this work? And there are a surprisingly large number of components involved in making it work. So firstly, we have XM, which is a command line tool. This is basically just how the user interacts with the system. I think there are other tools that you can use instead, but this is kind of the default standard one. So its job is to just accept commands from the user and send them on. It does a bit of parsing, and that's about all. And then Xen.D. XM and Xen.D. are kind of two halves of the same thing. It's almost like a client-server kind of arrangement. Xen.D. marshals all the information on the system that relates to running Xen, keeps track of that state, and communicates it on. So in this case, the most important things it's doing is it receives the commands from XM. It checks the local state of the system as it believes the system exists, makes sure that's all okay, and then passes it on to QEMU Xen. It doesn't really do very much, just kind of marshals the information, pass it on. QEMU Xen, so this is the part of Xen that emulates devices, and it actually turns out to be the part that controls hot plug or pass-through. So it's QEMU Xen that communicates with the hypervisor and makes the hypervisor set up the IOMU and things like this, so the pass-through is actually going to work. And then it triggers the BIOS in the guest, so it knows what's going on. And then the BIOS doesn't really do very much except just pass that information on up to the operating system. The operating system kind of takes notice of it, plugs into the device, sends back a response. Yeah, that's okay. And QEMU Xen gets this response. Anyway, it just goes back. It says, yeah, this is okay. And the state's being updated along the way. Both Xen.D and QEMU Xen keep state of the system. And if they get out of sync, you're in big trouble, basically. Xen.D gets a message, sends it to XM, and basically on the command line it says, yep, okay, hot plug. So what was hard about implementing, changing things from the situation where basically you only can do single function pass-through to multifunction pass-through? So it turns out that actually by far the hardest part of this problem was getting the user interaction right. And the bits that are not actually, you would think the hard part was getting, you know, the hypervisor all in order and all this kind of stuff. It was actually not there at all. It was towards the left of that sequence of events that I showed. So one problem I faced was, how can we succinctly represent this information in a way that the users can easily understand, and it's also difficult to get wrong. So this is where BDF notation comes in, which stands for bus device function. So we start off with the bus on the left, which in this case is 0, 0. Then we have the device, which is 2. And then we have the functions, 0. This is how you do it. This is the way you would represent a device that you are asking to be passed through. It's pretty straightforward. It's kind of hard to screw up. It's a notation that's commonly used for PCI, so it's kind of okay. There's a slight extension of this where you can have the domain in front of it. The domain is nothing to do with Xen domains. It's a PCI domain. You don't see it very often. But that's just for some systems have multiple domains. So that's pretty obvious, just put some more zeros on the front. Then before I got anywhere near this code, there were already some extensions to this to allow you to pass more information in. So the two extensions that were there was, firstly, you could specify the virtual slot number. So this is physical device number 2, function 0, and we want it, when it's in the guest, we want it to end up in slot 7. Fair enough. And then there's a few options we can pass. These options are hardly ever passed through, and up until last week, they didn't even work. But you can, the notation supports them. It's a bit of a mess. There are only two options, which will become important as we get a bit further on. And I'm not really sure what they do, because nobody uses them. So I wanted to extend this so I could somehow encapsulate a multifunction device in a way that was not confusing and difficult to get wrong. So I had three ideas, and I decided to put them all in. So instead of having a single function number, I thought it'd be nice to have a list of function numbers. So you could just do 1, 2, 3. That's nice. And then I thought it'd be nice to have a range of them, which is the example I've given. So I've gone 0 through 2, so that's 0, 1, 2. In retrospect, probably it wasn't really necessary because there's only a maximum of 8 elements in the list, and so a comma delimited is probably reasonable. And then I went a bit over the top and decided asterisks would represent all of them, which turns out to be not as useful as I expected. Anyway, so we have this notation which we can describe the same thing in various ways, but it's still fairly simple. And then that logically gets expanded out. So the notation here, 0 through 2, basically logically means 3 separate functions, and then we want that to be passed through somehow. So that was, when I got to here, I was pretty happy. Like, it's kind of nice, it's pretty succinct. I was pretty pleased. It took a while to implement, much longer than I expected. I wasn't very pleased about that, but generally I was pretty happy. And then someone came along and said, it's not enough. What we need is to be able to explicitly specify not only the slot where it ends up, but which function, which virtual function it's going to end up. So you can do these bizarre cross-mappings. I have no idea why you would want to do this. And I argued quite a bit that, in fact, it was not necessary. But I wanted to go through. So I had this idea to basically extend the notation further. And this is probably one of my least good ideas with regards to this project. So we have this horrible equal sign creeping in, and it's not obvious. It's not easy to get right. And if anyone has a better idea, I'd be happy to replace it. But essentially what this is doing is saying, so the first 2 there, next to the D, says I'm going to start with physical function 2, and that's going to be assigned to virtual, end up as function 0, and then we've got a dash because it's a range, and then physical function 0 is going to end up as virtual function 2 and interpret everything in between. It's hard to explain, it's hard to get right, but anyway. It's kind of okay because no one's going to use it. Yeah, so we can do these crazy cross-mappings now. Whatever. Which brings us to the question of how do we map the physical functions to the virtual functions. So my original idea was very simple. It was hard to get wrong. You would always end up with a valid result, which was just I would do an identity map. That had a few problems. The primary ones being, you always had to pass through virtual physical function 0, which you may or may not want to do. And that meant you, if you had a few functions left over, you could never pass them through as a different multifunction device. So that's a little bit limiting. So I just loosened it up a little bit. So on the previous slide, I mentioned you can set up the mappings yourself. Otherwise, basically what it does is it goes through the list of functions and it finds the one that's numerically lowest, which in this case is 1, maps that to 0 because we always must have 0 presence, very important, and then it just identity maps the result, the rest. This guarantees that it's always a valid device. It's pretty simple. It works. Okay, so This is another area of the code that's not really that exciting. We have to, in the case where these things aren't specified, which is almost all the time because most people don't really care, we have to be able to allocate them. So we need to allocate the virtual functions. Now, it turns out that that's a lot easier to do in Xen or Xen.D, which are basically the same thing, because it knows about this notion of multifunction devices. Most of the code doesn't understand about multifunction devices at all. It just understands about functions coming through as single units. Now, if you're only doing single function devices, that's fine because there's always a one-to-one relationship. It doesn't matter. So it knows, so it can, it has all the information required to do the mapping that was on the previous slide. So it does that. Allocating virtual slots, however, has to be done in a completely different part of the code over in QEMU because it's only QEMU that knows which slots are free. And this created all kind of problems with how to try and communicate with QEMU enough information because it only understands about functions. It doesn't understand about devices. That, you know, all of these, the next three functions that come through actually are all the same device. And you have to make sure you give them all the same device number. But anyway, I worked out a nice way around this. It's quite common to represent a device and function in a dev fender, which happens to fit into 8 bits by definition, so that's nice. You just have a 8-bit wide integer. All I did is I took an extra bit, which turned out not to be difficult in this case, and that's a flag bit. And the flag bit just basically tells it whether or not it's going to be doing auto assignment. And if the auto assignment is set, then it just ignores the function bits and fills them in itself. If it's not set, then it takes notice of them. And this turns out to work pretty well. The major difficulty that occurred while implementing this is that, probably for historical reasons, there were actually two different ways you could insert a device. There was one for the case where you were inserting the device when it booted up, and there was another for the case where you wanted to do hot plug. So I kind of rationalized that, and that allowed this system to work, because the previous system, not only were they different lumps of code, they just worked completely differently. Okay, so then I came up with the idea of device keys. So basically inside Xen.D, sometimes it needs to go through and marshal all the functions of a particular device. Well, how can it do this? It doesn't understand about devices, it just understands about functions. So I just added this key to the structure. And I actually just using the BDF string that was passed through, because that's guaranteed to be unique. And it basically just scans the list and gathers up all the ones that are together. The list's usually not very long, so that's fine. We'll see how that works. So when you want to attach a multifunction device, here's what happens. Firstly, it goes through and finds all the functions that have the same key. It's got them all. And then orders them, so function 0 is last, because function 0 is special. And then it goes, it attaches to the first function, and then if there's no more, it's done. If there are others, it just keeps going through this. But if the virtual slot is to be automatically assigned, that happens with QEMU, so it doesn't know what that is. So what it does is it inserts the first function, and then it finds out what device number was assigned to that, and then it assigns that to all the other functions and then inserts more. So that's also nasty. And right at the end, when QEMU Xen gets the function 0 pass through, it's only then that it notifies the BIOS. And the BIOS notifies the OS. And when that notification goes through for function 0, that is enough for the BIOS and the operating system to say, hey, here's a multifunction device. Here's all these other devices hanging around on the bus. Let's go for it. Okay, so detachment is actually a bit simpler because we don't have to worry about assigning slot numbers. We just find all the functions that have the same key, order them so function 0 is last, and detach them all. And again, QEMU Xen only gets a notification for the last this function 0. That's all it needs. Otherwise, it gets confused and the state gets inconsistent, and then you've got to reboot the whole machine. Okay, so actually kind of getting towards the end of this. I mentioned earlier that there was a restriction in the code that you could only use a maximum of two devices. And this was modeled on some kind of hardware restriction. I've never seen hot plug PCI hardware, but I guess so. Slot 6 and 7 were magic. It couldn't be used for anything else except hot plug, and you couldn't use anything else, and hot plug couldn't go anywhere else. This doesn't make any sense for a virtualized system at all. These slots are not physically special, they're just software. Anyway, so I fixed this up, and it actually made some of the code simpler, and it made some of the code longer. So particularly, the BIOS is written in this language called ASL, which stands for ACPI Source Language, I think. Anyway, it's fairly limited language, and my skills in it are even more limited. So we've got 32 lines of stuff we've got to do, that came out to, for 32 slots, and each slot has 8 functions. So it's just multiplication, comes out to about, well, the whole patch ended up with about 10,000 lines in the end. But that's okay, I automatically generated that, didn't sit down and type it all out. That was also a very wise move because I wasn't really sure how to do it, so every time I had to change it, I could just regenerate the whole thing again. And there were corresponding changes in QEMU Xen, although they were much, much, much smaller. There was an interesting bug that I introduced at this point. So when the event comes in, you basically look at which device the event's coming in for, and then you execute a specific piece of function in the program for that, inside the ASL code, inside the BIOS. I mean, it's kind of annoying. You've got to have a separate function for each little bit of hardware. So I have, like, 256 of these things. Wish I could get rid of it. But anyway, I haven't worked out a way to do it. So then I've just had this giant if statement. So you're just like, if it's device 0, function 0, do this. If it's device 0, function 1, do this. Just 256 different things it could do. And that worked. That worked pretty well. Except we noticed that on Windows XP, one version of Windows, probably all versions of Windows, it's worked fine unless you tried to use a slot above 8. And it turned out, basically, I'm still not sure exactly why, but what appears to have been happening is this if statement was taking too long. It didn't take that long, but it took too long, and Windows was timing out and getting bored. And so you could only use slots 1 through 7, which wasn't really very, very ideal. And if you tried to plug in a higher level slot, then actually the system would become inconsistent, and that means you have to reboot the whole machine. So anyway, I fixed that. I didn't fix it very well, the solution I came up with, which is interesting, but it's not very elegant, is now I just check each bit in turn, which means, this is an 8-bit number, there are 256 items, so you can represent that in an 8-bit number. And so I can get to any of the results in exactly 8 steps, but it's still this massive nested if statement. It's horrible. Anyway, if anyone knows ASL, happy for some help. All right, so in conclusion, made some incremental improvements to Xen, and did that work? And when Xen 4.0 comes out, which is any day now, it will be in there. And we've had not that many regressions. I think it works pretty well. I also fixed up the rest of the hot plug code, so actually hot plug PCI works a lot better in Xen now than it used to. I don't think it really works at all in 3.4. Or it's very easy to find cases where it doesn't. It was very interesting to me, and annoying, but interesting. It was actually the user's code that took all the time, and that was partly because of quality issues in the code, and partly because getting user interaction right is difficult. And possible scope for further work is the idea that you could take functions from different physical devices and use that to form a new virtual multifunction device. I would be surprised if that worked, and no one's asked for it, but it's an interesting idea. This work was done partly funded by the Ministry of Trade and Industry in Japan, so I'm very thankful for that. And if there are any questions, thank you.
So right at the start you said that function PCI devices have exactly 8 functions.
Yes.
What about ARI, which lets you go up to 256 functions per PCI device? I know at the moment we don't expose them as such. We kind of pretend that they're, you know, independent devices, but
I'm not familiar with that. So, no, I didn't take that into account in my design. Yes. Any more questions? Yes.
You said that you can mix, one of the future directions you want to do is mix multiple physical devices functions to construct a virtual multi-function device. Now, would it be possible to, say, mix multiple physical functions with virtual functions to construct a multi-function device as in...
Also an emulated device.
Right, partially emulated device.
It would be difficult the way the code's currently structured, but I think from an architectural point of view, it would be possible. I think so. There's not actually a whole lot of distinction made in the system between emulated and pass-through devices. The problem is that just their entry points and the way they're configured are different. Again, I would suspect that the hardest part about that would be to, well, firstly get rid of all the existing bugs you'd run into, and secondly, to get the user part right. Okay. If there's any questions or you try this and it doesn't work, please send me an email. My email's not on the screen, but thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Here is a gift for contributing to our conference.
Thank you.
And let's have more applause for Simon.